But just to reintroduce myself, my name is Bayo Akindende. I'm team leader for Private Enterprise Program, PEPZ, and Nyambuka Zambia is one of our components. The title for this session is Taking Your Business to the Next Level. So basically, how do you scale up your business? How do you grow it? We've got an interesting panel of speakers, and what I will do is start off by introducing them and asking them basic questions. And then after that, I'll open it up to you, because really it's for your benefit rather than just for our benefit. So on the extreme, I'm just trying to work it out, on the extreme left is Colin Ogilvy, the procurement director from Zambia Breweries, SAB Miller. In the middle is Mark Townsend of the enterprise business unit of MTN. And closest to me is Nitesh Patel, ex-PwC, PricewaterhouseCoopers, and now CEO of Astro Holdings, Zambia. So what I will do is kick off by, as I said, asking them questions. Get the conversation going, and after that, open it up to you. So I'll start with you, Colin. Just to also explain, Colin is also the chairman of our business linkages at committee at Private Enterprise Program. So start with you, Colin. You're already working with us on business linkages. We're very happy with that. And Colin is working with us looking at supporting how we look at linking small businesses to big business, i.e. to see how they buy much more locally. In terms of that kind of work, what would you say are the benefits that you see with small businesses or entrepreneurs just starting out, wanting to grow, but wanting to do that by linking up with established players like yourself?
Yeah, thank you, Brian. Okay. I mean, obviously, Zambia Breweries has for many years, they've believed in enterprise development and particularly local sourcing as being the great opportunity that exists for growth within the market, and obviously we rely heavily on small enterprise development for that. We are working obviously with the Business Linkages Program, and it's essentially a format for us to engage in a formal manner with suppliers which have been selected, SMEs that have been selected on common criteria, that have traditionally had or found it difficult to find access to the market. Many SMEs have often found it quite difficult to achieve critical mass, and looking to large corporates often find that the doors are closed and there's no formal mechanism by which they can approach these companies. And so this business linkage program offers SMEs the opportunity to engage with us in a formal manner, and obviously for us to work with new vetted vendors that have been proven to deliver over time. And so that is the opportunity that we like to tap into.
Yeah, thanks. And if I was to turn to you, Mark, and say, look, we've had lots of chats about what MTN does, other than just the sort of voice communications. Really, looking at what you do at MTN, how is it that you can use technology to scale up a business, to take advantage of what we have now?
Okay, I think the first aspect of scale is if you look at any industry or economy that is not technologically savvy, you have what's called opportunity loss. Okay, I'll give you a very basic example. You are sitting here today and you're enjoying yourself at the conference, but as we speak, there are potential customers who are trying to reach you, and they can't, okay, because you don't have the solutions in place for them to reach you. Through technology, you make yourself reachable 24/7 for a start, through email, through voicemail solutions, and so on and so forth. So that's the first part. The second part is online, okay? Through technology, online, you can give yourself a market that doesn't exist in your day-to-day running of your business. You're now able to project your business on a much larger market and then give that market the opportunity to engage with you. So it's reach, okay, through technology, And it's also reducing on that opportunity loss, ensuring that every lead, every opportunity potentially that's going to come to you is engaged and retrieved.
Now to you, Nitesh. If you don't mind me saying, you sort of come from PricewaterhouseCoopers, very professional organization. If you don't mind me saying, sort of boring accountancy profession. Well, I used to be an accountant as well. And now you're on the other side in business. Yeah. What would you say it takes to make that transition from running a small business to the big time, to running a big business?
I think in response to your question, when I, after 25 years of working for PwC in a well-oiled, structured military precision machinery, and I decided to make the transition, somebody sort of said to me, are you sure about moving over to the dark side? Which sort of obviously sort of resonates with Star Wars. I think the reality is that every business operates in a certain manner, some well-structured, some maybe not that structured, but the end goal is still the same. Mm-hmm. Now, if you look at what does it take to make a transition from a medium-sized business to a large, successful business in large scale, entrepreneurs generally are risk-takers. And they have grown the businesses from an idea and through control. And when I say control, what it is, an entrepreneur when he starts his business will be the finance manager, will be the IT manager, will be the HR manager, will basically run the business on his own sort of thing. And he's growing, and he's growing. And as he tries to grow the business into a much bigger business, then he has to let go of that control. And he has to make sure that he's supported by very, very good talent around him in supporting the IT function, the HR function, the finance function, so that he is not in any way, he or she rather, is not in any way precluded from coming up with more innovative ideas to grow that business. So really it's having a structure on the business that works, and the function, the structure must be functional, and the entrepreneurs can then carry on with new ideas, trying to sort of grow the business, coming up with new ideas, and just the way they started actually the actual businesses at the inception. Yeah. The advantage of trying to scale up and make it more successful is obviously when actually going out there to negotiate with suppliers, with negotiating with bankers, for example, they would like to see sort of robust financials, they would like to see robust business plans which actually demonstrate that this person or this business can actually assist us take the business to a new level, right? I'll give you an example myself. As Astro Holdings, we are a group of 24 companies, a self-financed business. We decided to go into a large venture, and we're looking for money to borrow. Now, the business itself is actually a very, very solid sort of thing. But when you look at the financials, it may not suggest that's the case. And obviously, as bankers, they need to sort of see robust financials. They like to see a good corporate governance structure in place. They would like to sort of be assured that the money is going to be safe. And so those are the main structures that are important, is the core functions of a business to be operating as they should to make the business more successful.
Yeah, thanks. The question I'll put to you again, Nitesh, is look, we're trying to do that. What would you say are the key things to look for small businesses wishing to grow from one level to another? Because we're supporting them right across. Mm-hmm. And then you will get a small business person just starting out with a different set of issues. You'll get someone who's trying to, who's looking for funding of about $500,000, mm-hmm. different set of issues.
Yeah.
But what would you say are the key distinguishing sort of issues between those types of businesses?
I think in the morning session, Brad actually summed up a very, very good point. It's not even about usually their ideas, it's actually your passion, the zeal, the vigor. Do you really have it? Do you want to do this? And if somebody had to come to me to sort of say, Nitesh, we want to support your business on the engineering side, and this is what we can actually do, I want to be convinced that that person is actually very, very committed to the business, and he will support me, right? Because inevitably, on a daily basis, we have a lot of linkages coming through. Some is just a business, others is actually a passion, and it's actually the passionate ones that we actually see will actually support us, and we can actually grow with them, and are prepared to listen to what we have to tell them as well. So I think this is the issue. So you have to work in partnership with your linkage partner, or do you just want to be a supplier? Yeah. If you just want to be a supplier, it doesn't really matter. There can be another supplier within 6 months.
Yeah. Yeah.
But if you want to be a partner, it's that partnership that what everybody's looking for.
Sure. Yeah. Fair point. Mark, at this point, I'm going to say, do you have examples of where information technology has helped transform how an SME does business, has helped transform how you take the business from one level to another.
I think if we look specifically at solutions like mobile advertising, okay? So mobile advertising gives an SME access to a much larger market for a fee to promote their particular business. So it's one very simple example. I look at another example. Let's look in the banking sector. So if we look in the banking sector, you now look at devices that carry point of sale that are sitting in shops. So for example, if I'm running a store, I don't have to have a customer now that comes in with cash. We can do card payments, which is much easier for that customer logistically. And through technology, we can build that network of card payment machines. Another quick example would be tracking. You know, through SIM cards, we can now track any device. Not just the phone, we can track cars. We can track usage on the cars. We can track fridges. We can track fridges in Collins' environment to tell them exactly where their Coca-Cola fridge might be or their Zambia Breweries fridge might be. So whether you're a small business or a large business, you can track your assets and you can know exactly where your assets are at any particular time.
Right. Thanks. What are the questions you'd like to ask the panel in terms of scaling up? What are the questions you'd like to ask in terms of how you use information technology? Or is it about linkages? Over to you.
You mentioned how online is viable and getting products to more customers. But don't you think the dynamics you're discussing are more applicable in Western countries or developed countries as opposed to Africa or most particular Zambia? Because how do you get your products online with a payment term when statistics prove that over 86% of people do not have a bank account, and of course very few people are financially literate, and there's also the issue of mistrust. Generally, consumers do not trust the method of paying first electronically and then waiting to receive their product. So do you not Then the second question is for you, Mr. Akindende.
For me?
Yes, yeah, you. the infrastructure that you have put up, as Pep said, is interesting, which is linking small businesses to, you know, large corporates. But the other thing that I've noticed is that it should incorporate some dialogue between the SMEs and the buyers. Because the situation is that we don't lack market. You know, as entrepreneurs, we survive by hunting. We know where to find the market. But these are people who take our products and then say, our policy is to take your products and pay you after 20 days. Now, looking at a business that is trying to scale, you've got employees, you've got expenses and overheads that are piling up. So how does it help a business to keep supplying a big buyer who will not pay them in a good time frame? At the end of the day, you leave your employees starving from their salary for a month or two. You know, your overheads are choking you, but you're still supplying. So would it not be beneficial if we could have an inclusive meeting and say, at least for businesses in this category, we can revise the policy to pay you, say, at the most in 5 days? That we can work with, but the occasional 60, 30 days is killing us, if I can say so. Thank you.
The first part is actually engaging the potential customer, okay, online. So I can tell you from an MTN perspective that we have about 1.4 million smartphones on our network right now. So that's 1.4 million potential customers for you. I can't say what our competition has, but they're probably around about the same. So let's assume that there's 3 million potential customers. That's a massive potential customer base for any product that you're selling. So that's the first part, which is, does the base exist and can we address them via a website or via an email or whatever it is we decide to address them. The second part is the payment terms. I agree with you. this is a challenge, and you know, companies have been challenged with this. But again, let's look at mobile money. So as MTN, we have about 2 million registered mobile money customers and about 400,000 active, meaning they are using the service as I speak, mobile money customers. So you've got 400,000 people who could pay you with MTN mobile money, and you're addressing a couple of million or 3 million if you're crossing networks, potential customers. For me, that's already a massive customer base. So I don't think we need to now think that we don't have that. And we have a payment option. And you could also do a payment on delivery. That option can exist as well. Trust element, of course, that's going to be a challenge. But it's a challenge with any business. You know, if I open a mechanics workshop tomorrow, I'm not all of a sudden going to have customers coming there for me to fix their car. They're not going to trust me. You have to build a brand. It's not instant. You don't get onto the online world today and tomorrow you're all of a sudden very big and your brand is very big. You have to build it, and you build it through trust. And you can do testimonials. Your customers can do testimonials. You can put yourself in some of these sites that rate you, you know, that they're independently rating you so that you can continue to build that reputation. And if the payment option still becomes a trust issue, then we can look at cash on delivery. The third point is logistically, and I think you mentioned that as well. But again, we trade so much logistically. You'd be amazed at what product moves from A to B and is sold in place C and D overnight or even within a few hours. So I think we mustn't think that is something for the West and you know, it can't work here. I really think we mustn't think that. We must think outside the box. Look at mobile money in East Africa. It was a concept that was created, and now it is the largest transfer of cash in the entire East Africa. And they built that specifically for their environment. So there is no reason why we can't create our own slightly different methodologies here, but deliver a virtual e-commerce platform.
Colin, I'm not sure if you want to talk a little bit about the Zambi to B platform under the linkages program.
Yeah, I think it somewhat addresses the question that was posed to you by, is that, you know, whilst we have this platform where we can engage both with SMEs and with other corporates, there is the behind-the-scenes support that PEPZ would offer through other programs. A lot of our SMEs do struggle with finance, with managing their supply chains, with managing technical issues within their business that they themselves are challenged with and they're not necessarily able to address themselves. Through that business linkage program and with the support of PEPZ, they can identify subject matter experts within that specific field from within their network that can support those SMEs in overcoming those challenges. And that service is available, it exists. And you know, certainly from our perspective, you know, we are currently engaged with an opportunity, and certainly it would require a degree of expert advice and knowledge in that field in order for them and for us to try and mutually reach a product which is actually suitable for our needs.
We are working in, as Colin said, we're doing a lot of work in that area. But one more thing, we had without mentioning the retail chain, we had a meeting with the supermarket retail chain where we brought the buyer, the finance man, and a couple of SMEs together. So we are engaging in dialogue with them. And what they've said, what they told us, is that they're able to change their payment terms depending on the circumstance of the supplier. Yes, they will sit with you, they will work out what works best for you. And they told us exactly how it works. And this is not me making this up. We sat down with them and walked them through with some of the suppliers we're working with. And as Colin said, we have a very active business linkages program looking specifically at those issues. So we are working on it. And hopefully, once we see how it works, we're then able to replicate it.
So many times now our SMEs are crying that they must ride on the big corporates for business linkages. How do you explain, if you are international, operating in this environment, and it's your international office which decides which creative agency for advertising will do, and you leave the Zambian scenario? Okay? So how are we going to deal with that? To help the SMEs, those who are in the creative industry, to create from this local scene, other than your XY international agency creating from London or New York. Okay? That's one. To Zambian breweries, we have heard that you're trying to prop up the art grower schemes to get, is it sorghum, into your material for beer. I just want to hear the story, whether it's successful. The last one, if you are going to be procuring internationally and you position your sourcing company in London and you know that we have local procurement specialists in here, how are we going to help the SMEs in Zambia? Thank you.
I mean, we are a global corporate. Let's be honest. We have a global procurement platform, and we obviously seek to deliver value for our shareholders. That is, without a doubt, what the expectations are. Nonetheless, Africa has presented a significant opportunity. We talked about the relatively immature markets that exist, and for us to tap into that remains one of the greatest opportunities. Procurement obviously seeks to drive as much value from the supply chain, from suppliers, as is possible, as long as it remains sustainable. Yes, there are some materials that we would look to source overseas. They present themselves as a global opportunity, be it malt or hops. Many of those items are not necessarily manufactured in the country at this point in time, but over time, should the scale and should that the economies of scale present themselves, we would certainly look at that. I'd just like to talk to an example in Tanzania, for instance, on labels, where they specifically were approached by a supplier who was not necessarily manufacturing labels at that point in time, a totally separate product, but came to Zambian Breweries, put a proposal together, and said, we would like to explore this opportunity with you, Tanzanian Breweries, that is. And they worked together to identify the most cost-effective source of material, labels, the actual paper itself, and they agreed on an extended period of time where that supplier was able to manage and to recover some of the input costs, initial capex that was necessary for that. At the same time, there was no compromise on quality, and there was no compromise on the standard of the product that was being presented. Those opportunities exist. They present themselves almost on a weekly basis in Zambia. Yes, foreign exchange rates, etc., they do play a part. And we are, as procurement, we are expected to deliver, but we make calls based on our sustainable business proposals. So for instance, if we are specifically looking to drive or assist a company that is we are engaged with within a specific product, we would certainly look to manage that with them, and we would take a long-term view on that supply as opposed to a short-term view. When we look at the impact of global sourcing, yes, there are certainly products that we're going to continuously import because the scale is just not there. But there are definitely products that are available within this market and can be manufactured within this market over time. It just scale, it doesn't necessarily present it right now.
Somebody else want to add to that?
We're a Zambian company. We are, unfortunately, my shareholders sit with me on Washama Road. So we don't actually have that problem of being dictated to by London or New York or whatever it is. But that said, I think, so where is Astro going in terms of trying to support local businesses? We are the largest furniture retailer in Zambia through the various outlets that we actually have. And until now, we've only been importing furniture purely because it made more commercial sense from a business perspective to import and sell here. Chinese furniture was cheaper. But what we are seeing is that there are changes in people's perception that cheap is not always the best. And I think that's actually very, very good for us. So what we have done is, having undertaken a detailed due diligence, we will now start manufacturing furniture in Zambia. And what we decided to do is that, rather than sort of do everything from A to Z, we want to be the manufacturer only an outlet. So discussions have already started with various people in the sawmill business to sort of say, right, we want a certain grade of mokwa wood, we want a certain grade of rosewood, and this is what we're going to manufacture, whether it be beds, whether it be tables, whatever it is sort of thing, school desks, doors, et cetera, et cetera. So we're moving in that direction to sort of say, right, we don't want to be involved in everything. We don't want to have a totally vertical integrated business, but only a certain component of the business, and let somebody else support us. But this is our requirement, and this is what we want. And if you don't meet that requirement, then we're not interested in you. So that means entrepreneurs have to scale up and sort of say, right, we want to linkage with Astra Holdings, and this is what we need to supply.
My question is, how many small entrepreneurs have you actually taken up to effect their payments on MTN money, if you have taken up any? Then also the other question could be, what are the conditions, what are the requirements for somebody to be taken up by MTN so that they can effect their payments on MTN money?
Are there rules, or maybe the downward linkage from the bigger companies, or even the laid down procedures that, say, one can look at before is picked as a linkage to that bigger company?
Mine is just a comment. MTN, Mark, you mentioned 1.4 million mobile money customers. Was it 2 million?
Registered, no, yes. 1.4 million MTN customers.
Yeah, yes. And only 400,000 active. Could it be that the reason for that is that MTN promotes mobile money as a money transfer and bill payment solution rather than a lifestyle product where people can actually improve their lives by using MTN money because it's convenient as your debit or credit card? I'm actually a great believer in mobile money, and I think there's a huge opportunity there, because if you look at what's happening in East Africa, it makes me wonder whether we're on the same continent.
What are you doing as big companies to help empower SMEs in this sector or in various other sectors that are facing similar challenges, and ensure that they are more competitive and that we actually realize the true meaning of helping to scale up SMEs? Thank you very much.
Very, very interesting question. I think the reality is that, you know, as corporates get larger, I hate to say, but they become ruthless, okay? Corporates are not there for charitable organizations. They're there to create shareholder value and maximize return to the shareholders, okay? Now, these corporates have, at some point in their life, have grown up as well, just as you are today, small SMEs. Astra Holdings, the genesis of Astra Holdings goes back to 1979. It started off as a small construction company. Today, it's a group of 24 companies spread across Zambia, South Africa, into neighboring countries, and as far as Dubai sort of thing, with an enterprise value of in excess of $300 million, which includes a bank as well, okay? Now, you don't grow to become a big corporate like that by being nice. Sometimes you have to be very, very hard. And my humble advice to you SMEs is that, like, you can't sit here and sort of say, what are you guys doing, what are you guys doing? You come to me and convince me I am the guy for you and I can support you. Then we're talking. But if you want to be given something on a platter, then we're not talking the same language, unfortunately. So let's be realistic here. You can't sit here and complain, well, we can't go to the bank because the finance is too expensive at 40%. Well, the reality is that, yes, it's too expensive. But look at other models. If you look at the Asian model, for example, Asian businesses grow through family finance, right? Families support them. And in doing supporting them, you have to be truthful and you have to be honest. If you take money, you've got to give it back. You can't be extravagant, you can't be flamboyant, you can't be driving a Range Rover Sport the first time you get your dividend check, no, right? So you grow your business by putting your money back into the business. You'll become successful, somebody will pick you up and sort of say, man, this is a guy who has been very successful, I wanna work with him, okay? So get out of this notion that I'm here with SME supporters, no. You, what have you got on the table? Because we've worked hard to get to where we are. What are you bringing to the table? It's as simple as that. Sorry.
Lots of different notes I've made here. So let me start on the first point. Just basically about technology, okay? In a lot of things in your business, there are multiple steps you have to follow to get to a certain level, okay? Step one, two, three, four, in finance, in recruitment, and so on. The beauty about technology is you can join the race very late and still be at the front, okay? There's a wonderful technology called a fax machine, all right? I promise you, you don't need a fax machine, okay? You don't need it, okay? You don't have to start with a fax machine. It's long gone. It's like that with technology, okay? Today's technology you can get and you can be right at the front. And you must always remember that. It's not multiple steps to get to that point. We talked about, there was a discussion around mobile money. Yes, there are a lot more registered customers than there are active customers. And when I say active, we talk about a short period. We measure in a very short period of time. The reason being is that we need to build ecosystems. We need you to build those ecosystems. We need retailers. We need merchants. We need companies that accept the mobile money. Because if I receive my mobile money and the first thing I do is cash out because I can't spend mobile money anywhere, then I'm defeating the purpose. So we have a drive, and I can't recall who mentioned it, but you can come to MTN and you can become a merchant. You can become a retailer. If you've got a shop, you can set yourself up to accept mobile money as a payment. And there's no, you know, we will put you into that ecosystem. So we have to build that ecosystem, but we need SMEs because SMEs are key to building that ecosystem for whatever products and services you supply. And if you transact with mobile money, you actually get preferential treatment as a supplier at MTN, okay? It's one of the areas that we provide preferential treatment to our suppliers, those suppliers who transact in mobile money. And you can use it for lots of different things. You know, you can use it in your retail sector, you can use it for bulk payments, so on and so forth. So it's really, really important to build that ecosystem and to build the merchants and to build the retailers. So I hope that answers all of those questions. There was one last question about specific engagement with MTN. I'll just come to a point that we are a technology business, and as we speak, we have a wonderful program going on with Bongo Hive. Bongo Hive, for those of you who don't know, is it's an area where developers congregate. I suppose is the best thing. They have there's resources there that they can use, and we've sponsored it. And we want apps developed, Zambian apps. Okay, and we're giving those developers access to our network. We're giving them access to the internet. We're giving them, and then we'll go into a profit share model. If their product is worthy and successful, we'll go into a profit share model. So if there's anyone here that's an app developer and you want to get in that scheme, you're more than welcome. And there's a medical one which is going to be launched very soon, and you'll see it. If you're an MTN subscriber, and you'll be able to have medical exchange with us, but there's all kinds. You can build applications for anything, and that is something that we're doing at our cost. Yes, we are assuming that we will find those really good entrepreneurs out there that will bring a product that we can both make some revenue out of. But for now, it's at MTN's cost. So we are in our space, doing a lot for the developers.
We as Zambian Breweries, or as any large corporate. Global corporate. We are here primarily to deliver value for our shareholders, but it has to be through a sustainable process and a sustainable system. We can't help everybody, and I think there is obviously a process whereby we would engage with SMEs who would offer unique value propositions to our business. And it unfortunately, we comply with global standards. We can't compromise on that. Quality is accepted, and it's a given. I think what the opportunity lies is to explore that, the unique service offering, and there is a process of accreditation, technical accreditation and commercial accreditation, and through that, you know, there is the opportunity to supply a large corporate like Zambian Breweries.
I'm saying this not just to promote our linkages program. We are working with small businesses in terms of getting accreditation. If it's what you need to trade with a larger firm, we will help you towards that. But if that's the requirement, that's the requirement. Because surely you wouldn't like to buy meat or ice cream and find that it's substandard. Yes? It has to meet an international standard. And if they're working here in this country, then it meets their global standard. It's not just a standard for Zambia. So please, if it's an issue for you, come to us. We can help you get to that standard. But you can't say, abandon the standard because I haven't got it. That's not going to be good enough. If you're driving your car, you don't expect it to break down because, well, we're in Zambia. It doesn't work that way. A BMW is a BMW, it's a Range Rover, whatever it is. Wherever it is, it has to meet international standards. The question is, we then need to raise our game here to meet those standards. That's competitiveness. That's doing very well. Right,
Bio,
are there any
Bio.
More?
Sorry, can I just want to give a simple example of what Bio just talked about. So within the group, we actually have restaurants, and we have a lot of suppliers of various products to the restaurants. And one of the key ingredients we actually use in our restaurants is actually cashew nuts. So we had this gentleman that came all the way from the Western province with a whole bag of cashew nuts, and he came to my office and he said, I've got cashew nuts, I believe you use them in the restaurant. And we looked at them and they were all sort of different shapes and different sizes and different colors and all that. And I said, look, we need to have a sort of consistent brand sort of thing. And so he said, okay, fine. I'll come back to you after 2 weeks. He went back and then he came back with another bag, which was slightly better, if not totally exactly what we wanted, but slightly better. And he said to me, I have, from the same bag, I have hived off the good stuff, and I now have half a bag here. And I said, look, I think we're getting somewhere, but it's still not what we want sort of thing. He stayed in Lusaka for a couple of days, and he dissected the bag again, and from that half a bag, we came to a quarter of a bag. My chairman and I were so impressed with the guy that he was so determined to work with us rather than whinge and moan to sort of say, you don't support us. He knew exactly what we wanted. He decided that, right, from rather than have 100% of nothing, I'm going to get 50% of something. Let me do this deal. And we signed up with him. He's now supplying us cashew nuts. He sends us a bag every week from a Western province, and he's happy. We're happy. But the reality is, like what I'm saying is that, you know, meet the expectations of the corporates as well. Then you have a deal. If you don't, then you don't have a deal, unfortunately. And that's the reality.
I have an established business, and we run an interior designing company. But every time we go, sorry, I'm just going to give an example. Like maybe we want to design the new store for MTN. MTN, we'll give them our bid. They won't pick us. They'll pick an international company. They'll say you have to be part of a group. You go to the group, say we go to PEP, they want us to start from the beginning, but we are already established. How ruthless do you want us to be for us to get into, to be accepted into the large corporate companies?
Okay, so I presume that's directed at me. Okay. Madam.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is directed to the director for Astra. Yes, it's about food processing. Yes, I've heard to say you are in furniture making, and you want to venture into making furniture using rosewood as well as mukwa, which is a step ahead for Zambia. Now, my question is, what will you do with the offcuts? Will you be processing them into plywood and make add value to the offcuts, make furniture for resale as well? Because my interest now is trying to find a linkage market for my product, which is starch. For I know that plywood can be mixed with starch to make furniture. Thank you very much.
Okay. So, very good question. I think nothing should go to waste. I totally believe in that. Last year when I was here at Nyamuka, somebody was actually making briquettes. basically out of sawdust, right? So what we're sort of saying is that out of every byproduct that we have, something has to happen to it. So the sawdust was obviously become, we're happy to sell that to somebody who's making briquettes, for example, right? We're happy to look at the offcuts and sort of say, what can we do with this? And we are happy to talk to anybody who's got innovative ideas to sort of say, right, we'll take this away from you and we can do X, Y, Z with it. Because at the end of the day, I get my wood, I want to make my piece of furniture. Whatever's left over, I have no need for it. But somebody can make use of that and do something with it. So we are happy to talk to you. If you have any ideas, so please, let's be in touch.
I know for a fact that when we're choosing a supplier as MTN, the fact that you're global or local actually doesn't make a difference. So long as it's up to a certain value. Obviously, much higher values, there is a global agreement that's in place, but that goes into like network equipment and so on. But for our shops and kiosks and other things. So, and sitting in those committees and being part of them as I am, I notice there are a lot of key things. So there's a technical aspect, you know, does the supplier fit that technical aspect? And does it fit the commercial aspect? I can't talk specifically about the design in the shops because that I don't know, but I know for sure that the last three tenders that I sat through were awarded to local companies because they did fit that technical requirement and they did fit that commercial requirement over and above the international companies. But the other point I just want to make is that as SMEs, your market, sometimes, and I know this from being an entrepreneur myself, is that sometimes you always look to the corporates to be your market. And sometimes we have to think about the other markets. You know, the actual SME market we're in can be an easier and bigger market to supply. You know, we can spend our whole day knocking on MTN's door and miss the opportunity of the local companies that we could be supplying or knocking on Zambia Bury's door. You know, so that aspect also has to come in because there is, and the local market, especially the SME market, is vast. So we must look into that market for opportunity as well, not always think about finding the opportunity at the corporate level because there's much less opportunity there.
Yeah, and I agree. I mean, I think that, you know, there is, I mean, clearly a distinction on the category and the product. You know, historically, obviously, the value plays a huge part. Global contracts exist. But when it comes to local indirects, there is a huge opportunity for any specific vendor to engage with us, for instance, as long as they comply with the agreed criteria and that technical accreditation is critical. And certainly we would not specifically select a international company over a local company, and that wouldn't be the driving factor. At the end of the day, it is about a sustainable delivery of a service that we would expect, regardless of who it comes from.
The issue of you came to PEPZ and they told you to meet certain requirements, we work through a structure. And one thing I would say is that in our work, what we try and do is encourage the larger firms to buy local, not for corporate social responsibility, but very simply on commercial terms, to tell them that yes, if you buy local, you're paying in kwacha, not in dollars. If you buy local, you have better access to the supplier. So it's in their interest as well to buy local. But again, as has been said, it has to meet certain standards. So it's a question of understanding what is required. Coming to us will help you meet those standards that they're asking for, or whatever it is that's the issue. We'll help you address that. But it's not going to happen overnight. It's going to take some time. And this is what we understand on our program, that look, we're supporting local businesses, but it doesn't mean that you turn up on a Monday and by Friday you have a contract. It takes time. There has to be confidence as well, just as you buy stuff yourself. I mean, we all buy on the basis of trust and confidence. So if someone's going to buy from you, they need to be sure that you could deliver. You need to have that, give them that confidence. We will work with you to do that, but they also would move a little bit. So it's a question of meeting both sides, meeting for both sides. And ask you, gentlemen,
to come up with, I don't know, I'll say maximum three tips or three things you would look at for the budding entrepreneurs who really are interested in, sorry, not interested, they want to be successful, they want to do well, right? What would you say are the three key issues? Summarize. I'll start with you, Colin.
You need to have a truly value-adding proposal, something that's different, I mean, that stands out. And you have to, there has to be a degree of transparency, there has to be a degree of flexibility around that. And I think that knowledge of your industry is critical. Understanding what you are proposing, what you are working with, understanding the risks is critical. Without knowing your product well, it's very difficult for you to sell it to us.
Look, I think the first point is you've got to digitize your business. Whatever that means, you know, for your business, e-commerce, or whether it's just the fact that you use email and you use some of those solutions. And I don't even mean using them through MTM, but you've got to digitize your business. It's the future. All the corporates are digitized. So if you want to deal with corporates, you've got to digitize your business. I think you should have courage. You know, I really think you should have courage, and you should be confident in what you're doing. Echoing on what Colin said, you need to be innovative. You know, the true success comes from innovation. If you're going to do the same thing that five other people have done, it's going to be very difficult to be successful. So be innovative. Take an idea and put it into something and have the courage to take it forward.
I think for me, it's the honesty and determination of an entrepreneur. You have to be realistic. You know, you've got to be resilient. The certain words that always echo in my mind that my dad told me when I was quite young, that life is not easy, it's hard. But to make it easier, you have to go through the hardship, right? So in your process, as you starting your journey as an entrepreneur, you will face a lot of hardship, but be determined, persevere, be resilient, right? And once have you been through the hardship, I think you set the foundation for the worst, right? And that will then make it that much easier for you. Those would be my words.
Colin, Mark, Nitesh, thank you very much. And I think they deserve a round of applause.
Thank you, Brian.
To you by Nyamuka Zambia and partner sponsors.